Our first talk is by Professor Elisa Bertino from the Purdue University. And the topic of the presentation is extremely important on Internet of Things, is about security and privacy. So Elisa, please have the floor.
Yeah, okay, good morning, good afternoon. Let me share my screen. This morning I'm going to discuss the main issue in security and privacy in IoT, and also provide an overview of some work we have done. Just to start, I don't think I need to tell you what IoT is, but certainly we can say that IoT, when combined with other technologies, including 5G cellular networks and machine learning, can support many new important applications, including applications for healthcare security. Those applications are becoming increasingly important today. And the one capability that we acquire with the pervasive deployment of IoT devices is the ability to continuously collect and data and analyze them in real time. In addition, we can also remotely control those devices, which is also very important for many applications, so that you don't need to have humans present in certain locations. On the other hand, this will also introduce the problem of safety. In addition, of course, to the problem of data privacy arising from the huge and pervasive data collections. So IoT, unfortunately, expands the attack surface of our system. And there are many reasons for my claim. First of all, IoT systems don't have a well-defined perimeter. If you want to say, which is my system, the system I need to protect, that's very difficult to say, because basically your system may continuously evolve and change because of mobilities. Sometimes IoT systems consist of several subsystems. So, and some of those subsystems may even be owned by different organizations. So protection, it becomes very complicated. Of course, in IoT, you have a lot of heterogeneity. For example, we have been looking at communication capabilities, and there are a lot of different ways in which those devices can communicate. In addition, IoT system may include the physically unprotected portion. So this means you may have a device which is somehow in the open air, and an attacker can walk in and take away this device. They will be highly autonomous and may control other autonomous systems. In particular, the autonomy of IoT systems is being made possible by development in AI, such as reinforcement learning, by which systems can learn in a way on their own, if you wish. Also, IoT systems may include objects not designed to be connected to the internet. A typical example where we see this is in the area of industrial IoT, because basically some objects were not designed, were not anticipated to be connected to internet, and therefore they don't have security capabilities. For example, they are unable to digitally sign messages, verifying those signatures and so forth. Finally, and this is perhaps the major challenge, is that the human interaction with all the device is not scalable. This means that basically in the future, the number of devices will outnumber the number of humans on the planet. And in many cases, security breaches happen because of poor configurations, because there are mistakes, for example, in firewall rules, in other critical configurations for security. And in many cases, also IoT systems are deployed in environments such as smart homes, smart cities, where not always there are skilled individuals able to manage and configure those systems. And it is important to notice that attacks evolve all the times. So you need, for example, to change certain configurations to better withstand those attacks. And this is really a problem. So we need the solutions by which somehow security can self-manage. So those are some of the challenges, the reasons why we'll have a problem in a way, if you wish. Of course, security is one problem. We have also privacy risks. I like this diagram a lot because it reminds me of Leonardo da Vinci, the famous Italian scientist. And basically, the human body, it will be, or it is already, one of the major sources of data. And this diagram is quite old, but today research and technology and industry have come up with many different new devices. For example, a lot of interesting ones have been developed to deal with social distancing in the current pandemics. And therefore, all this data, which is continuously collected, if it is not properly secured, may lead to privacy breaches. However, it is important to mention that threats arise for enterprises as well. In some enterprises, you have security policies by which you cannot carry in mobile phones and laptop inside of the premises of an organization. Those are typically highly sensitive organizations. And therefore, usually users are asked to leave those devices in the lobby, for example. But now when individuals have implanted devices or wearable devices, for example, smart contact lenses, it will be more difficult to enforce those policies. So a user can walk in with a smart contact lens, which has been compromised by a malicious party, and these lens can acquire images from the environment. So this is also a problem. Basically, will be a security problem as well as a privacy problem. Finally, I want to mention that when you have unsecure systems, you have also safety problem. It's clear that safety is different from security, but the two of them are strictly connected. And if you have a security risk, this may result in a safety risk. So I'll give you a very interesting example. This was an analysis done by two researchers. They looked at the smart toys. Those smart toys are very smart in the sense they have on a cloud an intelligent application which learns a lot about the specific child. So once a child gets a toy, the toy tries the child to interact with the child, like if the toy were a friend, were a human. So the result is that the child, and the idea is the child will trust this toy. Now, these colleagues have the software inside of those toys, and they found a lot of security vulnerabilities. For example, the toy collects a lot of information from the child. We'll ask the child a lot of things, so to become, again, familiar with the child. And however, the toy doesn't authenticate with which user the toy is talking to. So suppose the toy is left for 10 minutes on a bench in a park. Somebody can get the toy and start asking information about the child. So there was no authentication. Worst, the software analysis revealed that the software used an insecure key management approach. Basically, for communication between the toy and the cloud, symmetric key encryption was used, and there were a fixed number of keys, probably, I don't remember whether it was 14 or 16, which the client on the toy would rotate. So the toy, you know, in communicating would rotate among those keys, but the keys were the same for all the toys. So somebody could buy a toy, extract the keys from the software, and then being able to intercept communications of other toys with the cloud. Now, this is clearly a safety, will result in a safety vulnerability, because an attacker injects a message into the toy, and the message will instruct the toy to tell the child, open the door and walk out. Because those toys are designed to become friends with the child may follow this order and open the door and walk out. This is clearly a major safety risk. So of course, those colleagues contacted the company, informed them of what they had found, and hopefully they have fixed it. So we have a lot of natural questions, though, when we look at all those problems, is that we have a lot of security techniques. So security is an area which has been around for, you know, decades. A lot of research, a lot of investment. So can we apply those existing security techniques to IoT? Yeah, of course, we can apply many of them. But they, of course, needs to be engineered, needed to scale up, needed to deal with very dynamic systems. Because even though our current systems are already dynamic, but with IoT mobility, and in addition, these IoT devices may be much more exposed to direct interactions with humans. In addition, when new AI techniques will be deployed on IoT devices themselves or on edge device, which will then collaborate with those IoT devices, then there could be increased the safety risks, for example. In order to address those problems, we have a nice way to look is to look at a security life cycle. So security life cycle is a systematic way to look at the security problem. In general, you have a prepare and prevent. And this means that you need to deploy all the defenses, all the good security techniques, and follow good security practices. For example, using encryption with strong encryption algorithm, make sure applications don't have vulnerabilities, make sure that the communication protocols don't have vulnerabilities. So we have done a lot of work in all those various techniques and practices, including also security provisioning, because provide the security can be expensive. So you have a problem that you have a security budget, how do you best allocate your budget? But this may not be enough because attackers are smart and they can always find some way to hack into systems. So you need always to monitor your system to make sure that you detect anything unusual. And in general, this is done through anomaly detection systems, which are typically part of intrusion detection systems. Of course, just one such system is not enough. Typically, you may have intrusion detection systems, which monitor the network, and they, for example, must be driven by knowledge about the specific networks, because as I mentioned before, we may have a different type of communication technologies here, especially if you look at the 5G ecosystem and the next incoming 6G, you will see that the ecosystem is very complex. And usually those ecosystems will be complex systems of systems, and each subsystem may have its own communication technology. But you need also intrusion detections on the IoT devices themselves. Okay. And so I'm going to focus on this system, which is for detecting anomalies at the devices themselves. This is interesting because it poses some, technical issues which are interesting to look at. Then once you have found some anomalies, you need to quickly understand what is the reason for this anomaly. Is this an attack or is this just a natural problem, like a device is not functioning properly, for example, because the battery is low. The reason why you needed to do this very quickly in IoT environment is that those IoT environments rapidly change. If you are not quick to understand which is the problem that you are experimenting, then your system may change. By the time you get to analyze it, it will be too late. Finally, you need to contain the attack. So you need to block the attack, at least because in many cases you deal with critical system and they need to be able to continue working. So we have done work along all those different phases, and in some cases we had really to come up with new techniques. In some cases we needed to substantially extend existing one. Now I'll focus on one specific piece of work, which is very interesting. This is basically an intrusion detection system based on anomaly detection for IoT devices. And in our solution is particularly suitable for devices which have limited functionalities, not limited, but well-defined. Those devices have to do certain functions, so they're not general computer systems. And because they do very well-defined functions, you can baseline their behavior. So you learn their behavior of the processes running on the device. And then once you learn this baseline behavior, you can monitor at runtime their behavior to detect anomalies. But of course, there are certain challenges. First of all, learning cannot be done on the device themselves. Can be expensive, but also monitoring at runtime can be expensive, is done on the devices, because some of these anomaly detection may require running machine learning techniques like a neural network, which can be expensive. So the approach was to do this learning and monitoring at the edge. The idea is to have a split architecture in which our anomaly, let's say, detection system is split into two components. One very small component is located at the device itself. It's very small and it is basically a logger, which logs events happening on the device. Then this log is periodically sent to the actual engine, which will do the anomaly checking. And this edge may consist of a small machine, like it can even be a laptop or a small computer system. However, so this is very nice because it shows how you can partition this task among different components of an edge system. The problem, though, that you may kind of thinking about is that this requires the device to use this log. How can we prevent the attacker or detect whether the attacker is tampered with the log? Because if the attacker is able to modify that in the log to remove traces of the attacks, then the anomaly detection on the edge we won't be able to detect an anomaly. So our approach, which worked very well, was do not give the attacker the time. So if the attacker is the malware is doing actions, for example, making different system calls, won't have time to tamper with the log. Then the other problem, of course, is how big are those logs? Because those logs, again, require the device to collect the data to be stored into the log and be sent to the edge anomaly detector. It requires a kind of some resource usage at the IoT device itself. So we came up with a modular design on log. Briefly, this is our architecture. As you can see, we have the client side, the IoT side, where each device will have a small system monitor just in charge of collecting entries into those logs and send those logs to the server. The server will run the actual classifier. And notice also that we have three different layers of logs. So we have logs which are very minimal. You collect the device, the minimal amount of information. Then you have increased the detailed information. And finally, you have a third level. So this is our three layers monitors. The first layer only collects the process name and process ID. The second log collects certain metrics like CPU consumptions. The third level is the most expensive, collects a number of system calls. This table lists the type of calls about which we collect. And as we will see very shortly, with these logs, you get very precise, very high accuracy. For the problem of securing these logs, we have a technique by which the time, let's say, is divided into windows. And at the beginning of each window, the server will send an encrypted nonce to the log, then to the IoT device. The IoT device will get the entries from the log depending on the chosen level. We lash those entries, concatenate them with the nonce, and then we generate a new hash value. So this is the very well-known hash chain technique. And this step, and then the nonce is deleted from the device. Then after a certain interval, this process is repeated. The previous hash value is concatenated with the entries in the log, and so forth. At the end, we send the final value of the hash function with the final log entries. And the idea is that the attacker has a very short time to tamper the log. And therefore, it's very difficult for the attacker to tamper the entry, do the attack, and modify the log itself.
Elisa, one more minute, please.
Yeah, sure. So we have done a lot of experiments, and we found that the log level, which collects the system calls, has very high detection rate, 100%. And just as a result, we did this analysis collecting 4,000 IoT malware, did the experiment with all of them. So as you can see, this approach is very effective when you collect the system calls, because those metrics show that malicious processes have a very major differences in those metrics. You just, for example, can look at the number of the average number of calls to connect system calls. Those numbers are very different. So this is why this approach works very well. I have just mentioned one piece of work. There is a lot of research to be done. We need to protect IoT devices from cyber physical attacks, from ransomware. Safety, as I mentioned, is very critical, and we need to do work in leveraging edge for IoT security. So that's the end of my talk.
Well, thank you.
Stop sharing.
So the attendants, please, you can put your questions through the chat, and I will read them then for our speaker. So maybe meanwhile, while you type some questions, I can ask one from my side. Do you think we need to invest more on the organizational structures of the ecosystem in order to reach new levels of security? In other words, do we need to make a better relationship between the organizational structures of the IoT and the other organizational structures of the human organizations?
Yeah, that's a very good point, sure, because IoT devices, in many cases, they will directly interact with humans. And in general, security is not a problem. Security, privacy, and safety are not a problem that you can only solve on the technology basis, okay? It really needs proper organizational processes.
Thank you. There is another question here, that is, what is the most challenging topic that needs urgent solutions and therefore research?
In general, a lot of topics are very critical. What I want to say that, unfortunately, one problem that we keep seeing is the insecurity of software. This is a problem which has been around for a long time, and these IoT devices really may have software which is very insecure. We analyzed ourselves 15,000 mobile phone applications, and we found that a lot of them, I would say 25%, had the major authentication vulnerabilities. For example, they wouldn't check certificates from server. We checked the one-time password based on tokens, and those tokens were not random, for example, so an attacker could predict them. That's the problem. And of course, we have the same problem in IoT devices. So software security is the important foundation for security.
Thank you. There is another comment and question from Srinivas. It says, very interesting talk. And then the question, are there any overheads for your approach?
Our approach, yes. It has some overhead on the device. We didn't collect data. That's why we have three layers in our log. If you want to have a low overhead, you can only collect the list of process ID and process names. But this has a 75% accuracy because some malicious software uses names of benign processes. But still, 75% is a good level, if you want, of accuracy.
Thank you very much. So there are no more questions. So thank you very much for your very interesting presentation. It is really a challenging topic that